of Luke. All right. We'll read the first 12 verses. I'll read the odd number verses. Would you join me on the even numbered verses? Now on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they and certain other women with them came to the tomb bringing the spices which they had prepared. But they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. Then they went in and did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. And it happened, as they were greatly perplexed about this, that behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. Then, as they were afraid and bowed their faces to the earth, they said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spoke to you when he was still in Galilee, saying, 'The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day rise again.' And they remembered his words. Then they returned from the tomb and told all these things to the 11 and to all the rest. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the other women with them who told these things to the apostles. And their words seemed to them like idle tales, and they did not believe them. But Peter arose and ran to the tomb, and stooping down, he saw the linen cloths lying by themselves, and he departed, marveling to himself at what had happened." Would you all meditate on that passage, and I'll read us lead us in a prayer in just a moment. Lord, as we read this passage, we actually commemorate and remember today what happened 2,000 years ago when Peter ran to the tomb and he marveled at seeing the linen cloths lying there. Lord, this week we have thought about your great sacrifice. This morning, we think about all of that that happened prior to that. Everything you said was true, because on this morning you rose from the dead. Lord, I pray that we would remember to our own time that we were all dead in our trespasses and sin, and you gave us new life. And I pray for anybody out there that wonders whether this is a mystery or just a myth or a legend. Lord, it's far more than that. It's not just historical fact. It is to be personally possessed. Lord, we can come to know you as our Savior, as our Lord, and as our friend. And I pray this morning, for those of us who knew you, that that would be revived in our hearts again. Bring us back to our first love. For those who have never made that decision, I pray this morning, this resurrection morning, would be the day that they too would experience, know and experience the risen Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, good morning. We're glad for all of you that are here, all of you that are online. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. We're glad that you're here. If you'll look in your bulletins, it'll have all the announcements for this week. And then you'll notice there's a little section that you tear off. If you're visiting for the first time, if you would fill that out and then let us know, or turn that in when we worship our Lord through our tithes and offering, that'll be a big help to us. If you are visiting for the first time, Miss Jessica out in the lobby there has a gift for you. It's just our way of saying thank you for coming this morning. We're starting an Experiencing God small group on Friday, April 5th at 6:30 p.m. The sign-up sheet's available in the lobby. Books are $22, and you can talk to Miss Deborah or Chris about this. And that starts, I guess, this Friday. We're already into April. Communion and Deacon's Benevolence is next week, April 3rd and 4th, so be preparing your hearts for that time. The youth are having a spaghetti fundraising dinner on Sunday, April 14th, right after the service, right after Sunday morning service. We'll head over to the Family Life Center, and we'll be able to eat there. And if some of you want to take it home, they have takeout available as well. The tickets are $10. It includes spaghetti, salad, bread, drinks, and dessert. And you can get your tickets from any of the youth groups. So you see any youth,
Just ask them, they will have tickets for you. WMU Health Kits, you can choose to purchase the items. There's a list of them out in the lobby in that round table. Or if you just put a check for $15, put in the Membo Health Kits, we will go and get those supplies for you. All right. Oh, let's see. I got one more here. Golden Oaks, Tuesday, April 19th. Golden Oaks will meet at the church at 11 to carpool to the Mission Lake Prayer Garden in Gaston, South Carolina. Information and sign-up sheets are available in the church lobby there. If you have any questions, you can see Janelle or Shirley.
Creation gives to you.
Wonderful. I couldn't have done that. I'm so glad they did. They did a wonderful job. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward for this morning's tithes and offerings. While they're doing that, I will lead us in a word of prayer. So, Father, thank you again that we have this opportunity to worship you. We are continuing to worship you through song. Lord, in a moment, it'll be through the preaching of your word as people are being obedient to one of the two ordinances you set up for your church, which was water baptism. We'll have that today as well. In this moment, we worship you through our tithes and offerings. Thank you for providing for us. We're certainly going to learn this morning how much you provided for our spiritual needs, but you provide for our physical needs as well. Lord, we give back a small portion, acknowledging that it all belongs to you. And then, Lord, help us as a church to be wise stewards of those resources so that we can share this incredible message that Jesus is alive with our neighbors and beyond. In Jesus' name, amen.
Oh, Now will you all stand and join us as we sing Christ the Lord is Risen Today.
You may ask yourself, how can it matter? What happened long ago at Calvary? Does it make a bit of difference? Does it mean a thing today for you and me? Still comfort in his love. go, you will find redemption in the precious Lamb of God, His only Son, whose nail-scarred hands reach out to everyone.
There is still salvation.
Choir. Once again, we're glad that you're all here this morning. Whether you're here or watching us online, we're glad you're a part of our worship service. You're going to need a Bible so that you can follow along, so go ahead and get that now. So we're in the final day of what we know as Holy Week. Let's remember what's happened during this week. It started last Palm Sunday, where we began in Jerusalem with Jesus' triumphal entry into the city. And there were several events that happened between Palm Sunday and Wednesday. And then on Monday, Thursday, the two main events were the Last Supper in the upper room and the Garden of Gethsemane. The last Passover meal compared and contrasted Moses' symbolic lamb with Mary's saving lamb. The Passover feast told the story of the Messiah and that Jesus was the new covenant. And after the Last Supper with his disciples, he went to the Garden of Gethsemane to pray. That's a place that you can go and visit today. And we learned about the garden that was mentioned over the last couple days. It was a garden of olive trees, and God used Israel's familiarity with the olive to create a beautiful picture of what Jesus was doing for us in that moment in the Garden of Gethsemane. On Good Friday, we were reminded of that dark day where on Calvary's Hill, Jesus died for our sins. For your sins and for my sins. During the sunrise service, I noticed we spent some time at the empty tomb, which brings us to this Easter Sunday, where we remember the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Some folks think that we shouldn't celebrate Easter. They say it's inappropriate because for New Testament Christians, every first day of the week should be a celebration of the resurrection. In fact, every day should be a celebration of the resurrection. That's certainly true. It's also true that I love my wife, Deborah, every day. But once a year, we have this thing that's called an anniversary, where we remember the covenant that we made with each other and God. So I think we can take one Sunday each year to remember in a very special way how the Lord Jesus Christ conquered sin and death and hell and gave us the gift of eternal life. Now, some of you may know this, but there have been several attempts to explain away the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. There have been all sorts of theories that have been advanced since then, and to try and explain what happened other than a resurrection. On the screen, you see some of the more popular ones. In our middle school Bible class at Oakwood Christian Academy, we've been looking at each of these theories and comparing these theories to the historical facts of the resurrection of Jesus so we can see for ourselves which explanation best accounts for what happened that first Easter morning. Was it one of the theories that you see on the screen? Or was it actually that Jesus rose from the dead? So we're going to read actually about the first attempt to explain away the resurrection all the way back in Matthew 28 in just a few moments on the actual first day of Easter. But you see, the Christian faith is a resurrection faith. We don't serve a dead Savior. A dead Savior is nobody's Savior. A little boy was in a classroom and the teacher gave this assignment: write an essay on one of the world's greatest living men. Some wrote about the president, and others wrote about a member of Congress, and some thought about, and they wrote about people in the entertainment world, and others about people in the sports world. Well, some even wrote about scientists, and believe it or not, in that class, somebody wrote about a philosopher. But one little boy, this one little boy, wrote about Jesus Christ and did his essay on Jesus. When the teacher received the paper, she said, "Son, that's a nice paper, but you misunderstood the assignment. I said the world's greatest living man." He said, "But teacher, he is alive." Folks, he is alive. We don't serve a dead Savior. Not only is the Christian faith a resurrection faith, the Christian faith is also a reasonable faith. It does not require you to suspend your intellectual faculties so that you can believe. In fact, Hebrews 11:1 tells us that faith consists of substance and evidence. Substance and evidence are what we look for to determine facts, to determine the truth. And the Christian faith is a reasonable faith. For Christianity, facts and faith go together. Now, one of the things that Deborah loves is detective stories, whodunit stories. She listens, she reads. This is her thing. I know this. If I ever try to do anything cross to her, I'm a dead duck. She's going to have, there will be no alibi I can come up with. I'm just doomed, so I might as well not even try. Does anybody like those murder mystery stories, like playing detective, trying to figure it out? How many of you like to try to figure it out before you get to the end? Like the butler did it, right? You don't even have to read the end. You guys got it all figured out. So for our Easter service, I want to look at the substance and evidence for the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Is it a myth? Is it a legend? Is there a natural explanation for what happened on that first Easter morning? Or are the facts as presented in the Bible, are they an actual historical account of the events as they happened? We're going to do this morning by reviewing the eyewitness testimony. Now, let me make a comment about eyewitness testimony. You might wonder how reliable eyewitness testimony is in determining facts in the day, in this age of DNA evidence and things like that. Well, I looked at articles from Scientific American, The Economist, and one from the Association for Psychological Science. They all make the case that eyewitness memory is reliable. And we're going to look at the eyewitness testimony as recorded in Scripture, and you'll decide for yourself about the resurrection of Christ, whether it's fact or fiction. So turn in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians 15, and we're going to begin reading the first 8 verses. We read here, Paul writes, "Moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel which I preached to you, which you also received and in which you stand, by which also you are saved, if you hold fast that word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain." Paul begins this chapter with a statement of declaration. Specifically, he declares the gospel. Now, starting in verse 3, Paul tells us the substance and evidence of this gospel that he declares. "For I delivered to you, first of all, that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he was seen by Cephas and then by the 12. And after that, he was seen by over 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain to the present, but some have fallen asleep. After that, he was seen by James, then by all the apostles, and last of all, he was seen by me also as one born out of a due time. Now, within those eight verses are four statements of fact about our Lord Jesus Christ. And within those four statements, which we can reduce to four words, within those four words, we have the gospel. Those four words, did you see them? Died, buried, rose, and seen. I'd like to submit to you this morning for your consideration four things that are necessary according to this passage of Scripture if the gospel message is true. There are four facts that we can look at and evaluate for ourselves if the message of the gospel is true or just a myth. The first one is they saw for a fact that Jesus died. Look again in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 3. For I delivered to you first of all that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. Jesus was not crucified at a private execution. This was done publicly. Who saw Jesus crucified? Who saw that Jesus died? Who were the eyewitnesses? Well, first of all, they were the followers of Jesus. We read, there were also women looking on from afar, among whom were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James the Less, and Joses, and Salome, whom also followed him and ministered to him when he was in Galilee, and many other women who came up with him to Jerusalem. So if you remember Mary Magdalene, she was the one who Jesus delivered from being demon-possessed. Mary, the mother of Jesus. John 19, verse 25 tells us there was another Mary, the wife of Clopas, Salome, many other women. And besides the women, who else saw him on the cross and die? Well, the disciples. We read this. We read, when Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing by, he said to his mother, woman, behold your son. Then he said to the disciple, behold your mother. And from that hour, that disciple took her to his own home. So there was John. There were also the Roman soldiers. We read this. So when the centurion, those with him, now a Roman centurion would have been in charge of 100 soldiers. So they, when they were guarding Jesus, saw the earthquake and saw the things that happened, they feared greatly, saying, truly this was the Son of God. So now, in addition to the women, in addition to the disciples, you have the centurion and the 100 Roman soldiers that were there on Calvary's Hill. Then there was the crowd. We read this. The whole crowd who came together to that site, seeing what had been done, beat their breasts and returned. Remember, Jesus wasn't crucified alone. There were two criminals by him. We read, then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and the other who was crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. There was also the religious people, the members of the Jewish Sanhedrin. We read this in the Scriptures. Now, when evening had come, because it was the preparation day, that is, the day of the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a prominent council member who himself was waiting for the kingdom of God, coming and taking courage, went into Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. And Nicodemus, who at first came to Jesus by night, also came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 100 pounds. So now you have Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus. There were the officials of the Roman government that also saw that Jesus was dead. We read this. Pilate marveled that he was already dead, and summoning the centurion, he asked him if he had been dead for some time. So when he found out from the centurion, he granted the body to Joseph. So let's summarize. If you would have asked the women that evening, that afternoon and evening, they would have said, Jesus is dead. If you would have asked the disciples, they would have said, he is dead. If you would have asked the centurion and the Roman soldiers, they would have said, he is dead. If you would have asked the crowd would have said, he is dead. The true crucified by Jesus, those criminals, they would have said, he is dead. Joseph and Nicodemus and the religious leaders would have said, he is dead. Pilate himself said, you can have the body because he is dead. Not only is it a well-established fact that Jesus died, we also know that Jesus died for a purpose. Look again in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 3. For I delivered to you, first of all, that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins. You see, Jesus didn't die without a cause. He died for a reason, for a purpose. Let me share with you why Jesus died. He died as our sacrifice. The Apostle Paul writes this. He says, in Corinthians and Ephesians, that Christ died as a sacrifice for our sins. We read, for indeed Christ our Passover was sacrificed for us. The author of Hebrews states that Christ was a sacrifice for our sins. We read in Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 12, this verse, But this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down at the right hand of God. The Apostle Peter writes that Jesus carried, he bore our sins at Calvary. We read this in 1 Peter 2, verse 24, who himself bore our sins on his own body on the tree, having died to sins that we might live for righteousness, by whose stripes we are healed. God tells us in his word that not only Jesus died as a sacrifice for our sins, but he was also the ransom for our sins. In Paul's letter to Timothy, we read this, for there is one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself a ransom for all to be testified in due time. Both Paul and the author of the book of Hebrews states that Christ eternally redeemed us when he died on the cross for our sins. We read in Hebrews, not with the blood of goats and calves, but with his own blood he entered the most holy place once for all, having obtained eternal redemption. And then in Colossians, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. The Apostle Peter writes that Jesus redeemed us. We read this, knowing that you were not redeemed with corruptible things like silver or gold, but with the precious blood of the Lamb, of Christ, as a lamb without spot or blemish. The Apostle John states that we're redeemed to God because of Christ's death. We read this in Revelation, and they sang a new song saying, you're worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain and have redeemed us to God by your blood out of every tribe and tongue and people and nation. Not only did Jesus die as a sacrifice for our sins, he ransomed us, he redeemed us, he died as a propitiation for our sins. And a propitiation simply means the means by which sins are forgiven. How are sins forgiven? Was it by good works? Was it by the sacrifice of animals? Was it ultimately by the sacrifice of Jesus, his shed blood? Well, the Apostle Paul tells us this, whom God set forth as a propitiation by his blood through faith to demonstrate his righteousness, because in his forbearance God had passed over the sins that were previously committed. The Apostle John says something very similar. In this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sin. We've looked at the people that witnessed the death of Jesus. We've looked at the purpose of the death of Jesus. Let's look at the prophecies concerning Christ's death. The death of Jesus was not a man's plan or design, but was part of God's plan before the foundation of the world. Look again in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 3. For I delivered to you first of all, which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. I'm only going to mention two references here. Both of them I'm going to take from sermons that were preached in the New Testament. So they were among the very first sermons ever preached. Both of these reference the death of Christ, but they also reference the resurrection of Christ. And you can't have a resurrection unless there was first a death. First is Peter in his sermon at Pentecost in Acts chapter 2. He says, him being delivered by the determined purpose and foreknowledge of God, you see, Calvary was God's plan and purpose from the beginning. You've taken by lawless hands and have crucified and put to death, whom God raised, having loosed the pains of death, because it was not possible that he should be held by it. For David says concerning him, and this is where Peter quotes the Old Testament. He's quoting in Psalm 16, I foresaw the Lord always before my face, for he's at my right hand, that I might not be shaken. Therefore my heart rejoiced and my tongue was glad. Moreover, my flesh also will rest in hope, for you will not leave my soul in Hades, nor will you allow your Holy One to see corruption. Paul, in his multiple sermons in Acts 17, refers, he says this, how he reasoned with them from the Scriptures, explaining and demonstrating that Christ had to suffer and rise again from the dead. You see, the resurrection is central to Christianity, and in order to have a resurrection, you have to have a death so that a resurrection can happen. Now, we've seen that it's established fact that Jesus died. He died for a purpose, and he had died according to the Scriptures. Now, folks, not only is it an established historical fact that Jesus died, we also looked at his purpose in death, and we found that Christ died for our sins. He died in our place. He paid a debt that he did not owe because we owed a debt we could not pay. Christ also died according to the Old Testament Scriptures. It was predicted in the Old Testament and preached in the New Testament church. But notice our next word. Our next word is buried. Let's go back and read our verse again. For I delivered to you first of all which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scripture, and that he was buried. Jesus not only died, but he was buried in a tomb. Now, how do we know this? Again, let's look at the eyewitness accounts. First, there were members of the Jewish Sanhedrin. We read this After this, Joseph of Arimathea, being a disciple of Jesus, but secretly for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus, and Pilate gave him permission. So he came and took the body of Jesus. And Nicodemus, who at first came to Jesus by night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 100 pounds. Then they, who's the they? Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus, took the body of Jesus, bound it in strips of linen with the spices, as the custom of the Jews is to bury. Now, in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden. In the garden, there was a new tomb in which no one had yet been laid. So there they laid Jesus. So you have Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus. Notice the time and care that was taken to prepare the body of our Lord Jesus Christ for burial. Pastor was talking to three ladies at the church. The preacher asked what the ladies like, what they would want said at their funerals as people walked by their casket. And one lady said, "Oh, I hope they say my hair looks nice." Another one says, "I hope they say I look natural." Third one said, "I hope they say, look, she's moving." The body of Jesus was prepared and preserved, and it's for one primary reason. The Father had future plans for that body to move again. Now, who else saw the body of Jesus in the tomb? Well, there was a woman. We read this in Luke 23. And the women who had come with him from Galilee followed after, and they observed the tomb and how his body was laid. Remember, there were at least five women named in Scripture, if not more. And then there were what I call the others. Now listen to this. On the next day, which followed the day of preparation, the chief priests, the Pharisees, gathered together with Pilate and saying, "Sir, we remember while he was still alive how that deceiver said, 'After 3 days I'll rise.' Therefore command that the tomb be made secure until the third day, lest his disciples come by night and steal him away and say to the people, 'He's risen from the dead,' so the last deception will be worse than the first." Pilate said to them, "You have a guard. Go your way, make it as secure as you know how." And so they went and made the tomb secure, sealing the stone and setting the guards. So now you have the chief priests and the Pharisees, you have the government officials like Pilate and the Roman soldiers. There's a theory that nobody knew where Jesus was buried, and that's why it was said that he was resurrected from the dead. That's one of those theories that tries to explain that way. Well, folks, only one tomb was the brand new tomb of Joseph. Only one tomb was guarded by the Roman soldiers. Only one tomb had been sealed by the decree of Pontius Pilate, and only one tomb contained the shroud of the formerly dead corpse. As you can see from the scripture, they not only knew that he was buried, but they knew exactly where he was buried. All four gospel writers record the specific events of his burial. You know, I'm a bit taken aback by about how much space is devoted to the burial of Jesus. Matthew's gospel has 18 verses from Jesus' arrival at Golgotha until his final breath. And then 10 verses deal with the actual burial and preparation of the body. Matthew records 16 verses from the place of the skull to the Lord's death. There are 8 verses dealing with the actual burial and the preparation of the body. In the gospel of Luke, there's 14 verses from the arrival of Calvary until his last breath. He has 8 verses about the burial. John lists 14 verses about the cross, almost all of it just dialogue. There are 12 verses about the burial. Think about it. As much focus as the crucifixion rightly receives, by our count, 62 gospel verses, there are 38 verses about the burial. That's exactly 100 verses about the death and burial of our Lord Jesus Christ, with 38% of those verses focused on the burial itself. Now, this doesn't minimize the glory of his atoning death, but rather it emphasizes the importance of the fact that he was buried. Now, don't miss the importance of Jesus' burial. The burial is, among other things, a confirmation of his death. Why is confirmation of his physical death so very important? Well, death is the punishment of sin. The wages of sin is death. The soul that sins must die. This goes all the way back to the dawn of time, where in the Garden of Eden, God said to Adam, "But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat of it, for in the day that you eat of it, thou shalt surely die." Think about this. Had Jesus Christ not died a literal and physical death, then we would still be in our sins. Not only were the witnesses to the burial of Jesus, there was a divine purpose for the burial of Jesus, and the Old Testament also had prophecies about how Jesus would die and be buried. Take a look at Isaiah 53, verse 9. He had done no wrong. He had never deceived anyone, but he was buried like a criminal. He was put in a rich man's grave. There are several instances where Jesus predicted his burial. Let me share with you just two occurrences. First is in Matthew 12, where we read, "For as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the great fish, so the Son of Man will be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth." Now, another occurrence of Jesus mentioning his death is just before he entered Jerusalem on Palm Sunday. He had stopped in Bethany and was having dinner with several people, including Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, when Mary took very expensive oil and anointed Jesus with that oil. Jesus made this comment in Mark 14. "She's done what she could. She has come beforehand to anoint my body for burial." So now we've looked at two of our four words. We've looked at the facts concerning the death and the burial of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now there's a third thing, and this is very important. The fact that Jesus rose again. Let's again look in 1 Corinthians 15. We read, "For I delivered to you first of all that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scripture, that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures." At least once, Samuel Clemens, better known as Mark Twain, was listed as dead while being still alive. This type of erroneous obituary has occurred all too often in newspapers in our nation. On one such embarrassing occasion, a man whose obituary was printed in the paper rushed to the editor. The corpse lodged his protest. "How dare you print my obituary in the paper? I'm alive. See me, here I am." "I'm sure sorry," the editor said, "and it's too late to do anything about it. The best thing I can do for you is to put you in the birth column tomorrow morning and give you a fresh start." Well, Jesus' death wasn't misreported like the fellow in the newspaper. He had died, and he was buried. And that's exactly what those women who ran the tomb expected to find, a dead friend. But instead, they discovered an empty tomb. Now, the first thing that's noted on this first Easter morning is that the tomb where Jesus was buried was empty. The empty tomb is evidence of the resurrection, and it has an important part in the resurrection narrative. Now, who saw the empty tomb? Were there any eyewitnesses? Well, we read that there were women. "Now, on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they and certain other women with them came to the tomb, bringing the spices which they had prepared. But they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. Then they went in and did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary, the mother of James, and the other women with them who told these things to the apostles." Again, there are at least five women who saw the empty tomb: Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary, the mother of James, and at least other women. So that would be two or more. So that's a minimum of five. But who else saw that empty tomb? Well, the disciples did. We read this, John chapter 20. "Peter therefore went out, and the other disciple were going to the tomb. So they both ran together, and the other disciple outran Peter and came to the tomb first. And he, stooping down and looking in, saw the linen cloth lying there, yet he didn't go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. He saw the linen cloth lying there and the handkerchief that had been around his head, not lying with the linen cloth, but folded together in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who came to the tomb first went in also, and he saw and believed." So there's John and Peter, but was that all? Well, no, there were the Roman soldiers. "Now after the Sabbath, the first day of the week, began to dawn, Mary Magdalene, the other Mary, came to the tomb." We know from Luke's account there was some other women as well. "And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and rolled back the stone from the door and sat on it. His countenance was like lightning, and his clothing was white as snow. Now what happened to the guards? And the guards shook for fear of him and became like dead men." So what did the guards do? Now we read in verse 11. "Now while they were going, behold, some of the guard came into the city and reported to the chief priest all the things that had happened. And when they had assembled with the elders and consulted together, they gave a large sum of money to the soldiers, saying, 'Tell them his disciples came at night and stole him away while we slept. And if this comes to the governor's ears, we will appease him and make you secure.' So they took the money and did as they were instructed. And this saying is commonly reported among the Jews until this day." So the guards, the elders, the chief priests, and the soldiers all saw the empty tomb. And we now have our first alternative theory as to what happened to Jesus other than a resurrection for the dead, put forth by the Jewish religious leaders. They said the body was stolen. Well, we're going to have a baptism at the end of this service. You might wonder why we baptize for immersion. Because it's the picture of the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's a way to identify with Jesus. We read this. In fact, this is what I say when I'm baptizing. I said, therefore, as we were buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. You say, now, Pastor Sean, what does that verse mean? It means when he died, if you're born again, if you're saved, if you've accepted Christ as your Savior, when he died, you died. When he was buried, you were buried. And when he was raised, you were raised. Just like he got up, one day you will get up. We just looked at some of the people who saw the empty tomb, but what is the purpose of the resurrection? Well, here's a few that God's word gives us. First, the resurrection of Christ proves that Jesus Christ is who he claimed to be, the Son of God himself. You ask, Pastor Sean, where does it say that in the Bible? Well, we've been reading in Romans. And we read in chapter 1 and verse 4, and declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead. Some people believe that Christ's miracles prove his deity. They believe that Jesus healed the sick and cured lepers and gave sight to the blind and raised the dead and stilled the waters of the Sea of Galilee, that he was demonstrating his deity. But Jesus never claimed that. In fact, he again and again urged people not to tell of some miracle which he had wrought. Miracles do not prove the deity of Christ. Pastor Sean, how do you know that? Well, Moses, Joshua, Elijah, and Elisha, and Peter, and Paul, and others performed miracles by the power of God. None of the miracles of Jesus were intended to prove his deity. He helped the sick because of his compassion for them. He raised Lazarus for the glory of God, not to prove his deity. Miracles prove that one is from God, but they prove that for the apostles and the prophets as well as for Christ. The sign of Christ's deity is not simply that he worked miracles, but his resurrection from the dead. Destroy the resurrection of Jesus and you destroy the deity of Christ. That's why Paul writes in Romans chapter 1 and verse 4 and says, Christ was declared to be the Son of God with power, according to the Spirit of holiness, by the resurrection from the dead. Paul, preaching in the synagogue on the Sabbath day at Antioch, said this also. We'll pick up about halfway through his sermon. Oh, it's right there. But God raised him from the dead. He was seen for many days by those who came up with him from Galilee to Jerusalem, who are his witnesses to the people. And we declare to you the glad tidings that promise which was made to the fathers, God has fulfilled this for their children, and that he has raised up Jesus. As it is also written in the second Psalm, you are my son, today I have begotten you. On that verse that he's quoting from the second Psalm, J. Vernon McGee notes, doesn't refer to the birth of Christ, but rather to his resurrection. Not only does the resurrection prove that Jesus is the Son of God, the resurrection proves that Jesus Christ is the Savior of the world. We read in Romans 4, verse 25, who was delivered up because of our offenses and was raised for our justification. Since the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead is the one miracle that proves his deity, we can understand why Romans 10:9 says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Did I get that right, Ava? Did I get it right, what I said? That's their memory verse in elementary school, their Bible class. So we've been going over it. The Lord Jesus. Thou shalt be saved. Very good. So they've been going through Romans Road, getting all that memorized. So I was just having her check on me. I wasn't checking on her. I was having her check on me. Did I get it right? Did I get a thumbs up? I got to get a thumbs up here. Okay, I got it. All right, there we go. Thank you. I got Ava's official approval on that. I got the verse right. John Locke, the famous British philosopher, said this, our Savior's resurrection is truly of great importance in Christianity, so great that his being or not being the Messiah stands or falls with it, so that these two important articles are inseparable and in effect make but one. For since that time, believe one and you believe both, deny one of them, and you can believe neither. Not only does the resurrection prove that Jesus is the Son of God and the Savior of the world, but the resurrection of Christ gives us assurance that we too will be raised again to life. We read in Romans 8, verse 11, but if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. 1 Thessalonians 4, verse 14, for if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. Folks, Jesus' resurrection gives us assurance that those of us in Christ will not be defeated by death, but that we have victory over death, not because of anything we did, but because of what Christ did on the cross of Calvary. Easter guarantees eternal life for those of us who are saved, but if that's true, the opposite must also then be true. Easter also guarantees eternal death. Resurrection death, not resurrection life, in the judgment. A person without Christ, a person who has rejected Jesus as his or her Savior and Lord in this lifetime, will be raised from the dead and cast into hell. Easter guarantees it. Folks, that's a solemn thought. Now let me briefly look at the references of the Old Testament about the resurrection of Jesus. We mentioned earlier in Psalms 2 and verse 7, I will declare the decree, the Lord has said to me, you are my son, today I have begotten you. Peter quotes Psalm 16 and verse 10, for you'll not leave my soul in Sheol, nor will you allow your Holy One to see corruption. And Jesus used the example of Jonah in Matthew 12, verse 40, to point out his own death, burial, and resurrection. The Apostle John gives us insight into how the disciples were thinking about this in John 20 and verse 9. So, again, on that first Easter morning, what were they thinking? For as yet they did not know the Scripture that he must rise again from the dead. So, see, if you think, Pastor said something in the Bible, I must have missed it, you wouldn't be the first one. The disciples missed it when Jesus himself was telling them the Scripture. And so that gives me assurance that I can quote these, go over these things over and over because I need to be reminded because I forget. The resurrection gave meaning to all that had preceded it. By the resurrection, the cross was proved to be more than a tragic death, and the life of Jesus was proved to be infinitely more than just an example. Upon the fact of the historic resurrection stands or falls the whole fabric of Christianity. Unless Jesus of Nazareth actually came back from the grave, then indeed have we followed cunningly devised fables and have been hopelessly deceived. This has been recognized by the very enemies of Christianity. It was David Strauss who supported the naturalistic theories to explain away the resurrection, who said that the resurrection is the center of the center. Now, we've looked at the facts of Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection in that there was an empty tomb. But there's one more fact to consider, the fact that Jesus was seen after his resurrection. Let's look at 1 Corinthians 15 one more time and read these verses. And he was seen by Cephas, then by the 12, after he's seen by over 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remains to the present, but some have fallen asleep. After that, he was seen by James, then by all the apostles, and last of all, he was seen by me also as one born out of due time. That's the fourth thing. The apostles and over 500 eyewitnesses saw what they believed was the resurrected Jesus. Just on that first resurrection day alone, Jesus was seen by the women. Now, when he rose early on the first day of the week, he appeared to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he had cast seven demons. And then Mary, we read Matthew, and as they went to tell his disciples, behold, Jesus met them, saying, rejoice. And Jesus was seen by the disciples, saying, the Lord has risen indeed, and he's appeared to Simon. Cleopas and another in Luke chapter 24, the road to Emmaus, they saw and spent hours with Jesus. All the disciples, except Thomas, on that first Easter, that first Resurrection Sunday, we read this. So they rose up that very hour and returned to Jerusalem and found 11, and those who were with them gathered together. Now, as they said these things, Jesus himself stood in the midst of them, and he said to them, peace be to you. In the next week, Jesus was seen by all the disciples, including Thomas, who was the one missing that first Easter Sunday, but the next Sunday, they saw the risen Jesus and touched him. And there were other instances as well. Jesus was seen by over 500 witnesses at one time. Jesus was seen by James, the half-brother and skeptic. He was seen by all the apostles. Last of all, he was seen by Paul, the persecutor of the church on the road to Damascus. In 1 Corinthians 15, verse 17, Paul goes the opposite direction. He's been talking about how all this evidence proves that Jesus was raised from the dead. Now he points out just what is left of Christianity if Jesus is not raised from the dead. Paul said, if Jesus wasn't raised from the dead, our faith is futile, our witnessing is wicked, and our preaching is pointless. Every sermon ever preached from Pentecost until now is worthless, idle chatter if the tomb of Jesus isn't empty. A young aspiring preacher said this. He asked Vance Havner, he said, how many points should a good sermon have? Havner replied, at least one. There'd be no good points to any sermon except this. Christ the Lord is risen today. Sons of men and angels say, death in vain forbids him rise. Christ has opened paradise. If Jesus rose from the dead, it's the most important fact in human history. If he wasn't raised, nothing else really matters. Either the grave is empty or our faith is empty. It can't be neither and it can't be both. I've heard about a bus driver, and I always think of Mr. Lovelace, who retired from Greyhound Bus. And I think about a bus driver who said this, you can either stay on this bus or you can get off. Those are the only two options you have. You can either stay on the bus or you can get off, but you can't do both and you can't do neither. C.S. Lewis put it this way, one must keep pointing out that Christianity is a statement which, if false, is of no importance, and if true, is of infinite importance. The one thing it cannot be is moderately important. Christ died for our sins according to the Scripture. He was buried and was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures. Sir Lionel Lukhu, he's in the Guinness Book of World Records, he had 245 consecutive defense murder trial acquittals. So if you're ever up for a murder rap, this is the guy you want representing you. He never lost a case. He was also a skeptic concerning Jesus and the resurrection, so he was challenged to use his legal brilliance and apply it to the evidence of the resurrection. After years of research, he summarized his findings of his research this way. He said, I humbly add that I've spent more than 42 years as a defense trial lawyer appearing in many parts of the world and am still in active practice. I have been fortunate to secure a number of successes in jury trials, and I say unequivocally, the evidence for the resurrection of Jesus Christ is so overwhelming that it compels acceptance by proof, which leaves absolutely no room for doubt. This conclusion is from arguably the greatest attorney that ever lived. Jesus' resurrection proves what he said is true. Jesus is the only way to God in heaven. Stories told of a man who fell down in a hole. I've shared this with you before, but it seems appropriate for Easter morning. Stories told of a man who fell down in a hole and couldn't get out. A psychologist came along and asked, how does that hole make you feel? A moralist said, you shouldn't have fallen into that hole. An engineer passed by and said, well, that's an inescapable hole. It's 10 feet deep, 4 feet wide, and 10 feet long. A philosopher whispered, maybe you just think you're in a hole. A Baptist preacher said, and Dalton, I'm thinking of you about Thursday night, let me tell you three things about that hole. It's a big hole, it's a broad hole, and it's a bad hole. The pessimist opines, you'll never get out of that hole. Smiling TV preacher said, quit telling yourself you're in a hole. You're just on the top of an upside-down mountain. Then Jesus came, and Jesus got into that hole with the man and climbed out, carrying him on his big, strong back. Folks, here's the story of Easter. We are in a horrible pit of sin and death. Jesus Christ came and wanted to get out of that hole, get us out of that hole. In order to do so, he had to get in that hole with us, in that hole of sin and death. So he who knew no sin became sin and he died. But he overcame and got out of that hole. And now because of Jesus, we can get out of that hole of sin and death because of him. And that's something all the world needs to know. Years ago, I heard a story about a spider who saw the great massive lion go into a cave. The spider was envious of the king of the jungle. And he thought to himself, I'm going to imprison that lion in that cave while he's taking his nap. So while the lion was asleep, that spider started weaving a web, started going one end and going to the other and then coming back. He went up and down and side by side. He kept weaving and weaving and weaving his web. Finally, he had closed in the cave. And he said, now that mighty beast is my prisoner. No longer will he seek his prey in the dark and the night of the jungle. No longer will he bask in the golden sunlight. Now I've taken him captive. He's my slave. But the old lion awoke from his nap, shook the dust off his mane, gave a yawn, stretched himself, and then let out a roar that echoed throughout the valley and the hill. Then he walked out of that cave and never even knew the spider's web was there. You see, sin and hate wove a web of unbelief across the tomb of our Savior Jesus Christ. But the Lion of the tribe of Judah rose from the dead, And he never even knew the devil's flimsy web was there. Jesus is alive. He's alive today. Would you all pray? I'll ask those that are going to be prepared for baptism, if you'll head out to my right, please. Easter is a morning where many of us come. Some of us don't normally come to church, but we'll come on certain occasions. But Easter is one of those mornings to make us should be a time to pause and reflect. Many of us here this morning have probably prayed to receive Christ as their Savior and Lord. But there might be somebody listening online this morning or maybe later on today that hasn't. And then again, there might be somebody here that hasn't. Or there might be somebody listening who has walked away. I used to believe, I used to do this, I just don't do it. Or maybe that's you here. Easter morning is a reminder that nothing can keep us from the love of God. That Christ's death was sufficient, not only to save us for all eternity, but to help us to be able to live life now, the way God intends us. And I want to pray for you this morning, if that's you. Maybe you've never accepted Christ. Maybe you've walked away. Maybe you know you're not living for Him right now. Maybe there's something between you and Him. Whether you're here or online, I want to pray for you this morning. Lord, I thank You Your death is efficacious, and it is sufficient. The marvel for me is, how do You keep us for all eternity? I just marvel, how do You keep me through today? But Lord, I know based on the facts as presented in Your Word concerning Your life, death, burial, resurrection, and sightings, that when You said, "You are the way, the truth, and the life, no one comes to the Father but by Me," that is the truth. There is no other way. The only two groups of people in this world, the saved and the lost. Lord, I pray for those this morning, someone here, someone online, that doesn't know You as Savior or has walked away. I pray that this would be that morning that they would say, "I want new life." Lord, I've walked away. I want to come home. Lord, I pray that You would give that person online courage to be able to pray that. They don't need me to repeat a prayer. Lord, when You're speaking to them, You'll even give them the words to say. And I pray that if they do, we have an email address. Please reach out to us. We would love to rejoice in that decision. And Lord, I pray for those here. I know there's other decisions that could be made, anywhere from baptism. Several have made a decision for baptism. And there's other prayer requests and needs. Lord, I ask that in this moment that You would accomplish Your good purpose, Your will, for bringing us here together this morning in this particular service. Please do Your work in the lives of Your people. In Jesus' name. I'm going to ask you to stand and sing. Should you have a prayer need, should you need to make a decision, I will be down front. It would be my privilege to pray with you. So while I'm there, Miss Kay, would you go ahead and get us started?
I hear His voice of cheer and just.
All right. I'm going to go back and get changed real quick. Miss Kay, you've got something ready?
Yes, sir.
All right.
I'm just going to be able to sit and meditate for a moment. Just have a seat, please.
Thank you. first one who's going to be baptized is Ava. Ms. Angie, would you come up and read her testimony? We'll need the, you'll have the pulpit mic on.
I'm sure.
Okay. I am 8 years old, so I haven't had much life experience yet. Lately, I've had dreams and visions. I last had a dream that pushed me into this decision. I dreamed of the sun exploding and there was an asteroid. And then God said to me, I have a little more time. I am doing this not because anyone has talked me into this, but because God has been interacting with me in my life.
Ava, have you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Based upon your profession of faith and in obedience to His command, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now, grab your notes. Got it. Good. Buried in the likeness of His death. Raised in the likeness of His resurrection. You are in the name. She was ready to dive in.
All I remember is just going down.
Got to keep that. Okay, good. All right. This is Izzy.
My name is Izzy Wilkins, and I was really young when I asked Jesus in my heart. I can't really remember a time that I didn't know about God, and I want Him near me. I want to get baptized because the Bible says that we need to get baptized, and I want to be obedient and do what God says. When I was a baby, we always had family devotion before bed, and I've always loved to hear about baby Jesus and would often ask to read this story at devotion time. When I was three, I wanted to be where my big sister was at Oakwood VBS. One of the helpers asked if I wanted to stay. I took her by the hand, and I went with her to VBS. Jesus died not just for me, but for everybody. My favorite Bible verse is 1 John 4:18. There is no fear in love. Instead, perfect love drives out fear. When I get scared, I always declare His promise. God is with me. I really feel close to God when we have our family devotions. We've been studying Genesis 1 and doing a kids' precept study. I really enjoy marking the words and learning more about God. When I learned about Philip baptizing the person along the road, I started thinking that I needed to get baptized. I remembered when I was younger, I saw my sister Ella get baptized, and I believed that I needed to be baptized to show everyone how much I love Jesus. I'm thankful for my Sunday school teachers, like Miss Sarah, Miss Colleen, Miss Shirley, Miss Deborah, Miss Nancy, Mr. Al. I am also thankful for my mom, my dad, my nanas, and my papas. Who have all taught me about Jesus and God. I'm thankful for God's Word. I really enjoy reading and memorizing scriptures. I'm thankful for choir and being able to sing about Jesus. And I am thankful that I can pray and believe in God. I am a little bit scared, but a whole lot excited to get baptized today because I want everyone to know that I am a Christian and that I am not ashamed of the gospel.
Lizzie, have you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
Yes, sir.
Based upon your profession of faith and in obedience to his command, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried in the likeness of his death, raised in the likeness of his resurrection, to walk in newness of life.
My name is Joshua Wilkins, and I've decided to get baptized because I accepted Jesus as my Savior. The reason baptism is important is because it shows the world and my friends and my family that I am growing in my walk with Jesus. I believe that God sent his Son to save us from our sins. I've learned that Jesus wants us all to live with him in heaven. There will be no pain or sorrow in heaven, and I want to be with him there. When I was 5, I was adopted. God provided a family who loved me and took me in. God was showing me what he was like with my new family. I know that God loves me. I first heard about Jesus in my last foster family. I was really young, and I remember that they would take me to church. When I came to live with my forever family, we had devotions every night, and we went to church. We pray, and we would read the Bible. And that means a lot to me. Jesus is my friend, and I can trust him because he is with me at night when I'm scared. I can pray to him, and he's with me. He comforts me when I pray. My favorite Bible story is when Jesus brought Lazarus from the grave. I like this story because it shows that Jesus is powerful and can perform miracles. I feel loved by Jesus when I learn about him in Sunday school. My favorite thing about church is talking to my teachers like Miss Nancy, Mr. Al, Miss Kay, Miss Angela, Miss Sarah, Miss Brittany, because they make me feel loved and special. I am thankful for Jesus dying on the cross for me. I look forward to showing my friends and family that I have my life to Jesus by being baptized.
All right, take a step forward here, Josh. Josh, have you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
He said yes, by the way. Well, based upon your profession of faith and in obedience to his command, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go ahead. Buried in the likeness of his death, raised in the likeness of his resurrection, to walk in the name of God. Augie, did you bring back up?
I was okay until everybody started, so. All right, good morning, y'all. So I'm going to read Jonathan's story. My name is Jonathan Nogler. My Jesus story starts when I was little. Thomas, get ready. Wherever Thomas sat. All right. Mom and Dad always had me in church. I grew up in Oakwood. I didn't have what my mom calls that aha moment in my life, where I just knew I needed a Savior. Instead, it happened as I grew. I knew Jesus was my Savior, and I asked him into my heart. Pastor Sean explained this was a big commitment like a marriage. It's like this major promise to surrender to his will, and that's what I did.
All right. Jonathan, have you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Well, based upon your profession of faith and in obedience to his command, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go ahead and do that. Buried in the likeness of his death, raised in the likeness of his resurrection, to walk in the name of God. We'll wait. I'll tell you. I think I got it this time, but thank you.
All right. And I'm sure everybody here has heard Jonathan's name once or twice. All right. Christopher Nogler. The start of my testimony begins a few years ago. The previous pastor of the church, Pastor Rich, was leaving to go into the missions field, and I had been going to church for a while. I knew Jesus had died for our sins, and I thought I had full understanding of what that truly meant. So to show that, I asked if I could get baptized by Pastor Rich before he left, and I did. After that, it didn't feel like much had changed. I was still sinning just as bad, and if not worse than before. I began to stray from God, and for a while stopped coming to church. Then about 2 years ago, when I was at a very low point, I started to come back to church, looking for help and guidance. I was immediately welcomed back by everyone from the youth group, men's prayer breakfast, and the choir. Everyone was extremely kind and helpful to me. I felt like I was able to relate to some of the people, finally, who had been through similar things that I've experienced. Last summer, the youth group went on their somersault trip, which is where I understood that I had to put my full trust in God and follow Him. So I talked with one of the teachers there and got saved.
All right. Chris, have you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
All right. Based upon your profession of faith and obedience to His command, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now you can do that. Thank you.
Let's switch places.
I was given the honor to read Kim's testimony. I wasn't going to cry. I grew up in church. From the time I can remember, I was always in GA's VBS or other church activities growing up. When I was old enough, I was involved in music. When I was young, I made the decision to accept Christ as my Savior at VBS and was baptized. I continued in church, eventually teaching Sunday school and leading the youth groups. I didn't realize something was missing. As I grew older, got married, and had children, I drifted away from church. It's a very easy thing to do when we get busy with our lives. Something always seemed more important. I knew my kids needed to be in church, but knowing and doing are two different things. Praying didn't take a priority. My relationship with God was not a priority. But hey, I was saved, so I was good. In 2012, I was diagnosed with a lethal kidney disease. Overnight, my life changed. I was told I had maybe 2 years before I would be on dialysis and need a kidney transplant. It is so easy to be what we think a Christian should be when things are good, or even just okay. It is much harder when you have basically a death sentence over your head. We started treatments. It was awful, to say the least. I ballooned to almost 200 pounds, and the medication caused my body to hurt with excruciating cramps. I couldn't play with my kids, and I became depressed. At my lowest point, I told my husband to take the kids and leave because my life, I didn't want them to see it. But I didn't pray, and I didn't feel the peace that people talk about in times like this. I was angry. Why did this great God that I serve do this to me? I'm a good person. I'm a Christian. I was saved, right? One day as I watched Nagi play with the boys outside, I was struggling to wash dishes and I broke. I fell down on my knees and cried, "Why, God? Why is this my life? Why are you doing this to me now?" I finally felt that peace that people talk about. I felt healed. I finally opened my heart and truly accepted Jesus as my Savior with an adult's comprehension of what this truly meant. We started coming to Oakwood. We got our children involved. I'm in remission. We don't know if or when my kidneys will fail again, but I know matter what I am, I'm held in the arms of God, and ultimately, I know where I will be. That is a peace and joy that I cling to and hope that everyone can have. Sometimes we think we are saved, but we haven't truly made that commitment. It is never too late.
Kim, have you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
Oh, yeah.
Based upon his profession of faith and obedience to His command, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Buried in the likeness of His death.
Raised in the likeness of His resurrection to walk in the name of God.
was raised in a Christian home and went to church regularly and was involved in all activities the church had to offer growing up. God was always important to me, an important part of my life. And although my participation stalled when I got older, I never quit praying or believing in God and in Jesus Christ. I have had many life-changing losses, three husbands, my oldest son, and a granddaughter. I know that often when there is a death of a loved one, it is not common to become angry with God or question why he would allow such thing to happen. I can honestly say that although my losses have been devastating, I've never felt that God has abandoned me. Matthew 5:4 promised that they that mourn shall be comforted. Deep in my core, I feel the comfort and know that Heavenly Father loves me, loves us all, and that he has a plan for that is designed as show his love and ultimately for our happiness. I get peace from that nowadays, that knowledge. I know he loves me, and I know he is always here for me, and that he sends his Holy Spirit to me. In John 14:18, Jesus says, I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. He has come to me. I know that I was directed to Oakwood Baptist by the Spirit through the sweet sister of mine, Miss Norma. I was led here to gain comfort in my sorrow, to learn and grow and serve in love and understanding I received in here. Thank you all. I testify to you that Heavenly Father loves me and cares for me. Isaiah 41:10 tells us, "Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not dismay, for I am your God. I will strengthen you, I will help you, and I will hold you with the right hand of my righteousness." I know God sent his only son to suffer, die, and rise from the dead for the redemption of our sins, my sin. I am so happy to be here today, baptized by faith and begin a new chapter in my life here at Oakwood.
Christy, have you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
I have.
Based upon your profession of faith and obedience to his command, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go ahead and introduce me.
In the likeness of his death, raised in the likeness of his resurrection, to walk in the newness of the world.
All right, Brother Dalton and Miss Kay, would you close us out, pray, and then pray? Yes. Thank you very much. God bless you all. Happy Easter.
For prayer. What a service, isn't that right? Amen. Amen. Let's bow. Father, we thank you for your grace and mercy yet again. Lord, we thank you for the meaning of this great day. Lord, we thank you for rising again. Lord, we pray now that you'd bless each one that's in this service as we go our separate ways, whether it be to a family gathering or whatsoever it be, might you bless it. Lord, we thank you for showing up in this service. We ask now you'd bless us. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.